1 minute. What's it look like over there?
Are you going to want to?
You ready? Hello, everybody, and thank you for listening to 99.9 WUCC, where you always hear the voice of truth. My name is Pastor Steve Hall from the Johnston Church of God, and you are now entering our program. It is called In the Last Days, and we have a wonderful lineup for you tonight. We have here in the studio behind the controls again, Minister Steve. Good to see you, Stevie Bauer.
Amen. It's always good to be here speaking on the radio with my brothers about the Lord, something that's always relief to our hearts. That's
right. Amen. So, and also I have here Brother RPI.
Yeah, and I'm back, and
he's back in the hot seat.
Hey, I'm full of energy today.
Hopefully I see you're fidgeting over there. did you eat a big cake of sugar and a big Coca-Cola? What did you do?
I don't know. It's just, you know, everything is happening, and I'm just excited. At first, I was a little worried, but God told me, no, don't worry about that. I got this.
He's got it.
And I'm just excited. I know that Jesus can come back at any time, Pastor Steve. Anytime.
Amen, brother. He is coming. That's the message that burns in my heart.
Yes.
I told some more people today, Jesus is coming.
Me too. That's right.
And he is. We're not telling a story. Jesus Christ is coming soon. I mean, very soon. You need to be ready, because you are living in the last days. And no, we don't know the day. We don't know the very hour.
Yeah,
but
right.
We know the days. We know the signs of the times that will be all around us. And if you open your eyes, you will see the time in which you are living in is described perfectly by Jesus in the New Testament.
Amen.
So get ready. Jesus is coming.
That's right. He's coming. He's coming soon. So you better be ready. But we're going to let my minister, Steve, to tell us how they can listen to us.
Yeah, go ahead.
And then, too, before we get started, we're going to do this right, Pastor Steve.
Go ahead. Help me.
If you listen tomorrow around about 2 o'clock, you're not listening live. You listen to the rebroadcast.
Thanks for listening.
And thank you for listening. But
don't call in. It won't work. Yep. But tonight, if it's Tuesday.
That's right.
It's 7 o'clock.
That's right.
All right. So they can call in tonight.
That's right.
And this is how they're going to call in. Minister Steve, give it to them.
The number is 803-335-3131, 803-335-3131. We're giving it out early today.
That's right.
We're getting straight. So this is going to be in kind of open format tonight.
Yeah.
Our topic is going to be, and it was chosen by Brother RPI. Brother RPI introduced the topic, and then we'll go to a song.
The topic is being deceived.
And there's a bunch of that, isn't
there? Oh, yeah, in these last days. You got to be ready.
All right. So how about that song, brother?
Yes. So we're going to, well, before we play the song, like RPI was saying, if you want to watch us live here, you can go to our site, and it's cwchrist.com. And in the middle of the page, you'll see the little box, and all you do is push play, and you can see us in the studio. There's a little button, so you can go to Ustream if you want. And at the bottom, you can go to Listen Live to just listen on the internet. And you can watch our previous broadcast on YouTube, too. So come in and watch, because they're being goofy over here.
Yeah, we're trying to mess him up. We did a good job, too. Yeah.
That's right.
Now we're going to listen to We Believe.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and only one foundation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And expectations. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. Let the lost be found, and the dead be raised. In the here and now, the living vain. Let the church live loud, our God will say, we believe, we believe. And the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. We believe, we believe.
We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit.
I believe in Jesus.
You better believe now.
I believe in the blood.
That's right.
I believe He's coming again.
Amen.
And I believe it soon.
Real soon.
And I'm going to tell you what else I believe.
What you believe, brother?
I believe there is an opposing force.
That's right.
I believe the spiritual, demonic world is busy right now.
Oh, yeah.
I think they're pulling double and triple shifts.
Oh, yeah.
Of course, they never get tired.
Oh, no.
And I know the Bible says they seek rest. They go to the dry places and they seek rest. But I think the rest that they're looking for is to possess a body.
Exactly.
That's
right.
That's when they are at home, when they're in a body.
And
so they're not resting until they find a place to get in you.
And there you go. I was just about to say, they're trying to rest in our body.
Amen.
And I tell you, that's, thank God for deliverance. You know, that is an awesome thing. But once you go through deliverance, you got to maintain your deliverance. That's one of the problems that we start running now, people going through deliverance and not maintaining it.
Yeah,
and
because those demons come right back.
They come right back.
And they want to come back in
exactly.
that house.
And
exactly. if you let them back in, it's going to be worse. And
it's
it is.
Worse. It is.
And so what people must realize is if you want to be delivered, God is there to deliver you.
Exactly.
Because that's part of salvation.
It is.
Yes. Okay, but and then you have to maintain what you gain. It does no good for a country to be taken over, you know, to go and take over some enemy country and then turn around and get right back to them.
That's right.
Well, it's just like exercising. If you think you're going to exercise one day and you're going to be fit for the rest of your life, that's
Come
not going to work
good
out.
Exercise.
Yeah,
that's
it didn't
good.
Work for me. I'm
going to
try that. It didn't work for me. Did good one day. Ooh, the muscles bulging and all that. You know, oh, man, I got to work some more. Get fat.
Well, I got sore, so I said, this ain't for me. My muscles hurt too much. I just won't worry about them anymore. My muscles are on their own.
That's right.
See, that's what's going on with people. They get through salvation or they get through the deliverance, and they're like, oh, this is kind of too much for me. Let me stop. And they think, oh, I did my deliverance, so I'm fine now. You know,
yeah.
Me and God are right, but that's not how it works.
Right.
And Minister Steve, I think that's so true, because a lot of people go through it and they don't pray. Oh, I'm free. No, you got to maintain it.
Yeah.
That's just like your car. Just because you put gas in, you ride around for a whole week, that don't mean you're good. You still got to put gas in it. And that's the same thing with deliver. You have to maintain it. You got to get in your word, seek God. I recommend praise and worship.
Oh, yeah.
It's good to have praise and worship. It's good to get into your word. Right now, I thank God for giving my prayer life back. I'm so happy. I go into my walk-in closet, and I'm getting a hold of God, speaking in tongues, and it was a fight. Yes, it was a fight for RPI to do that because I didn't have time, or this came up, or I was too tired. No, my life is on the line.
Come on,
brother. God is requiring me the responsibility to share faith, share his coming to the people. And sometimes by doing that, I have to fight spiritual warfares. And if I'm not spiritually strong, I can be mentally and physically strong, but if I'm not spiritually, then I lose everything.
That's good.
So I am now in the process of building myself, like you get those muscles, I'm spiritually getting myself, getting to my word. Me and my wife, I thank God for my wife. She was supposed to come today, but unfortunately enough, she had a real bad sinus infection, which kept her down, and she's been fighting with it. And I thank God because she hadn't been taking no medicine. She Amen. Is trusted. And I'm telling you, in these last days, we talking about being deceived, Satan deceiving these last days. And when the things happen, you have to be in position to trust God, because when the economy collapses, I don't know when that's going to happen.
Soon.
I've seen it happen because they lying to us right now, and that's another deception. They lying to us, tell you everything good. Oh, the stock market was a glitch. No, I believe that the stock market started crashing, and they stopped it. So it won't. That's what they did in 2008, 777. It didn't stop. They stopped it. They just don't have to stop it on God's number. So you got to be in a position where you got to believe for your healing. I was sitting in my in load at work today, and I noticed when I took my glasses off, my vision wasn't as bad as it was. And I'm like, you know, okay, God, is this something you're showing me? Slowly progress. And I was able to drive around without my glasses.
Oh, praise God for that.
And I put them back on, but I'm steady receiving and believing, because
Amen.
It's going to be time where I can't get my medicine, you know?
Sounds to me like as you get closer to God, you get closer to your miracle.
That's right. That's what oh, wow, Pastor, that's so awesome. That is what we have to start doing. The closer we get with God, the closer God show his divine power. We all want to see God's divine power, especially in the last day, because everything going to escalate now. I was telling Pastor Steve.
Tell you what, I'm just going to let you do the show now, because you're doing such a good job.
I'm enjoying
this. Go ahead.
No, I was telling Pastor Steve today, we had a, you know, everybody know about the Planned Parenthood, how they was deceiving people that was going through it.
Yeah.
And how that lady sit there and casually say, hey, we just crushed the baby heads and saved the heart and get the liver. Well, one thing about a liver, it can be a size of a baby, but when you connect it to a human liver, it grows right into, you know, a full adult. So that scandal came out. God is showing you things. God is showing people this is what they doing. Then we had another situation happen with the with Obama going to Kenya. And this also showing you that there are still people standing for the word of God. Try to bring up homosexuality, and that meant that a president from Kenya said, listen, we don't do that here.
Right.
We are a Christian nation. We represent Jesus. You take your Americanized lifestyle back to America, we don't do that here. He immediately shut Barack Obama down when he brought that up. And this is where we got to start standing as Christians.
I love that. That's so awesome. He went back to the homeland of his father, and he took the trash from America that he has allowed, and that he has sponsored, and he has fostered, and he has supported this gay and lesbian movement, and helped them out an awful lot, by the way.
That's right.
But anyway, and he calls and congratulates the basketball players and all when they come out. But what about when a Christian comes out?
Yeah.
What about when we get saved? You know, they get saved and they get on the court and they write John 3:16. They can't find a job next year.
That's right.
What's his name? Tebow?
Tim Tebow. Prime example. God is blessing them.
And then they want to get on their knees and thank Jesus because they made a touchdown.
Wow.
They get persecuted and they tell them not to do that. But there you go. See, he went over there and in his homeland of his father said, you can take your trash back to your country.
That's right.
And guess what? They're right. That trash is in this country.
That's right.
And we see. Go ahead.
No. Go ahead.
And we see how, because the first time I read the story, it wasn't that, a Christian president told Barack Obama they didn't believe in that. It said, Kenya president brutally shut down gays and homosexuals and all this. And see, they set up this false wall so people think, that person is wrong. And when people don't actually look for stuff, and when people don't actually use looking through these things through God's eyes, they believe everything. And I'm
exactly
like,
right.
They're totally wrong. Why would they do that? And that's not how it works.
It's not. God.
But that's deception. You don't know exactly what we're talking about. That is national, an international correspondence between two presidents. And one of them is under deception. That's right. That's our Barack Obama.
That's right. We praying for him.
Yeah, we are. And I'm not trying to run him too far in the ground today. But then you got another president says, well, we not allowing that stuff.
That's right.
Here. Don't you come in here trying to persuade my people to adopt your morality.
That's right.
And we're not buying it.
And they went into the public streets, just an unknown guy, and the guy like, that is American version. You can't bring that here. We are Christians, and we don't believe in that. So don't bring that to us because we're not going to do it.
Amen. So,
another news.
That's a deception.
It is a big deception.
Now, and if the kind of lipstick you put on a pig, still a pig.
That's right.
It's still a pig. And it's going to oink and it's going to root. The other things that a pig does, I don't care what you say about it, it's still going to be swine.
That's right. Even though if you clean them up and put them on the tux, as soon as he get outside, the first thing he'll do is jump in that mud and swallow around.
So there's a great deception. Let's talk about some of the areas of deception. Let's talk about spiritual deception going on in the church. Is there any deception in the church, brothers?
Yeah, yes. Yeah. Sad to say it is.
What would y'all say is the biggest deception right now that's going through the American church? Just stay on America because most of our listeners are here. Thank God for our overseas listeners. Yeah. And if you are, we're not trying to demean you, but we're just trying to stay focused on America. What would you say the biggest deception is in, generalizing now, the American church?
I think one of the biggest deception is telling the people that you're living in sin is okay.
Yeah, tolerating sin.
Tolerating sin, yeah.
Because they don't want to be labeled as intolerant.
Yeah.
That seems to be the label everybody's trying to get out from under.
I'm not going to say the name Joe Osteen. Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. But that's okay. But anyway, you can call names. They call names. We can call names. But anyway, this is what I'm trying to say. And I believe y'all are right.
Yeah.
Is that the compromising of the holiness that the church is supposed to have in itself. It is to be therefore holy, even as your Father which is in heaven is holy.
Exactly.
So we have the commandment to walk in and try to be into perfection, but then we have the pastors and teachers and spiritual leaders that are saying, you know what? We don't have to be that way anymore. Look at modern man. Look at the way we think. Look at the way we act now. So I think the problem is we've let down the guard. And because we've let down the guard, it's created an epidemic of tolerance.
Amen.
An epidemic of tolerance.
That's right.
And we think we have to tolerate everything and bring it to equal in God's eyes. And you can't take a lifestyle of the ones that God declares himself to being absolutely despicable, amen, absolutely detestable.
Exactly.
Absolutely an abomination was what the word says in his sight, and then make it equal with the marriage between a man and a woman who's raising their children in church. And they give unto the Lord in tithes and offerings, and their bodies a sacrifice and filled with the Holy Ghost. You know, you can't make those two equal in God's eyes.
You can't.
So when you bring them to church, this is how I see it, and the church sees both of these and different people's groups sitting together, when they say we're all one in the eyes of God.
Yes.
And when they did take this big old broad stroke and they say we're all one in the eyes of God and God loves us all. Wow. Amen. Well, I'm going to tell you what. We're all not the same in God's eyes. Jesus looked at the scribes and Pharisees and said, you generation and brood of vipers.
Exactly.
Now then he would look at others and he'd say, you know, that man, there's nobody has faith like him.
Exactly.
And then he would look at the widow who gave her two mites and she says, nobody gave like her. You see what I'm saying?
Exactly.
But then he looks at those and says, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee the wrath that is to come?
That's right.
So, yeah, you call it as it is because God will and God still does.
That's amen. Right. I think what the church doesn't understand is that when they're saying, okay, everything's okay, if you're in sin, that's fine, you can still come to church, is they're making people not hot or cold, but lukewarm.
There you
and
go.
What does the Bible say about lukewarm water? That
spew
God
it
spews it out and... I mean, it's just you're coasting.
Yeah.
And people think, oh, no, I'm going to church, but, you know, I'm okay with doing whatever sin I'm doing. But no, you're coasting and you can't coast.
Yeah.
You always got to be in action. You always got to be doing something. You always got to be praying, reading your Bible. And even when you do those things, you have to remember, okay, I do sin on occasion, but I have to keep trying so I don't sin as much.
And I repent. I don't go on and just excuse myself when I mess up. I bring myself back to the cross and I say, Father, forgive me.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus, wash my mistakes away, wash my sins away. And he does, he takes care, because if we confess our sin, he's just and faithful to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And I think we have to get back to our roots of true biblical morality, which is living sin-free
before
God.
Before God.
And not worry about what everybody else is saying about us and our morality and our intolerance and our bigotry. And, you know, we're being called a lot of things by politicians and newsmakers and newscasters and the liberal media. And I've got some clips of Hillary Clinton in 2004 saying that the marriage of a man and a woman was biblical and she would uphold that. And that was her view. And that was in 2004.
Wow.
But when she got on there this year, she said that religious, something like intolerance, must be changed. Religious intolerance must be changed against these other people's groups, like, you know, the homosexual movement. And so she just flip-flopped right there.
Yeah. Yeah, you when you're living in sin big time like that, you tend to do that.
I'm
going to get a scripture, Matthew 24, starting with verse, let's make sure I said that right, verse 4. And Jesus answered and said unto him, take heed that no man deceive you, for many shall come in my name, saying Christ, and shall deceive many.
So Jesus warns, doesn't he?
He warns us.
Don't let them deceive you.
Exactly.
But they're coming to deceive you.
That's right.
And they look like pretty little lambs. They so innocent. Listen, they talk so inspiring. They're so soft and gentle. Look at the fuzzy little lamb on the, look at the fuzzy wool on the fuzzy little lamb. And on the inside, they're a wolf. And we got a lot of that stuff going on.
It's called a wolf in sheep's clothing.
That's right.
Yeah.
And go ahead, Pastor. I'm sorry.
But anyway, you know, you're making a good point there that Jesus warned us.
He did.
That's Jesus saying, you know, but don't be deceived. Don't be deceived, because many will be deceived.
And some of us get deceived, you know, through hurt. We will get hurt. Oh, tell them what you want to hear. Some of them deceived by money. You know what I'm saying? You giving the person money. Well, if you do this, then I will give you this and all that. And I think that's where a lot of some of our pastors fall into that when they start making a certain amount of money or a certain amount of things.
Yeah.
They worry about, well, if I say this, this is going to offend them. So another deception is false doctrine.
Oh, yeah. Change the doctrine to make people feel comfortable. There's a book out called The Cult of the Comfortable.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Think of the name of the book. The Cult of the Comfortable.
Wow.
That is a powerful thing in our culture today.
That's right.
And, you know, self-deception goes into that.
It does.
We can deceive our own selves. We can read that Bible every day and pray every day, and we can still be deceived.
That's right.
You can be doing what you know to be doing, and the devil can come, and you can be deceived because you began to get comfortable, you began to relax too much, and then you become to think of your ideas and your ways as being okay with God's ways.
That's right.
And we are self-deceived then. And
very.
So we're not, it's not just Antichrist trying to come and deceive us, is that the devil will get you to deceive your own self.
Yes.
And excuse your own sin and excuse your own mental machine and let it run anywhere you want to. And you can excuse yourself and say, well, I'm still better than everybody else. I'm ready to go when Jesus comes.
That's right.
But, and the whole time, you're not ready to come. You're not ready to go if he comes now.
That's right. Look at this next scripture.
Go ahead.
Verse 24, Matthew 24, verse 24. And it said, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets and shall show great signs and wonder, in so much that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect.
And the elect are those that are, whose names are in the Lamb's Book of Life.
That's right.
So the deception gets so powerful.
That's right.
That those who are walking in the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost could also, even if it weren't for God's protection, they could also be drawn into it. That's a powerful deception.
It is.
I'm going to tell you what, America is under this delusion that it is correct and that it is not deceived in taking the Word of God out of schools. It's not deceived in allowing all marriage to be equal to what God said was between a man and a woman.
Amen.
And they're not deceived by, you know, the junk that's going on in the world, immorality.
That's just like, for example, and it's perfect you said that, like, how can we as America that call ourselves a Christian nation can be deceived in Detroit, Michigan, can put up a bathonet, which is the devil with the goat head with children as a statue? How do we get so far-fetched that we had to put this statue up
Is it up already?
It's up already in Detroit. They made a veiling with 700 people doing witchcraft.
I seen that on Facebook. You probably posted it. My wife probably got it.
And
I seen that, and it was a statue. It was very
demonic.
It looks like a demon sitting on a throne with the one hand up.
Yeah, one hand up and had children.
And horns, like, and then somebody there's a pentagram in
that's
there.
That's right. It's the Baphomet, which was a false god they used to worship back in, I call it, in Bible times. It was one of the false gods that they worship, and now they bring it up because the Satan, whatever his name is, the guy that was, made a big fuss about it. Say, hey, y'all got the Ten Commandments, y'all got this, which one of the things that America has is the freedom of speech or freedom of right. And
freedom of expression. And freedom of expression. Stuff, right?
Now they want to take that same thing to Kansas and put it right beside the Ten Commandments, which they said, that's where it all started. This offends me. So they want to put that statue right beside it. Yeah. And this is the world we live in, where they are so deceived that the court system said it was okay. Okay. So you can imagine, they say that when they unveiled that, them people was dying there, eyes rolling the back of the head, doing worshiping and sacrifice. I mean, how is that good to have that, you know? And your excuse, well, we got to have the freedom of speech. Okay, well, when Satan come in there and start tearing your home up, I want that same freedom of speech that you put up in your house. This is deception that we living in right now.
Yes, it is.
Right now.
And people are going for it.
Yes, they going for it. Oh, it's no, that why they can't have it? Then before you know it, you got, and I tell you now, and I'm saying this, and I'm not, I love all homosexuals. I really do. I just pray that God, that they trust, you know, God, that they turn their lives over.
Right, yes.
And they get right. But they are got so bold in Sweden, they're going to have a march in two of the worst Muslim community, which is tomorrow, July 29th. And this is, you know, this is how they being deceived by Satan. Satan working two sides. He deceived the Muslim, thinking that their religion's right, and deceiving the homosexuals, think they're right. So he's going to bring them all together, which everybody know that how Muslims feel about homosexuals. There's two ways you can fix them. You stone them to death or put them on a tall building and push them down, which I don't really understand that. But they're going to march in Sweden in the two Muslim community, and they're going to march and say great pride. Now, the Sweden Police Department says that when they have a high-speed chase in the car, now not running, when those guys driving the Muslim community, they stop. They do not go in because it's so bad.
Wow.
So tomorrow, I'm going to pray that. And if he's like, why should you pray for them? Because they are still God. Now, they're not God children. Now, they're the creation of God. See, a lot of people say, well, I'm God's child, but you're drinking, smoking, cussing, homong and doing everything. No, you're not God's child. You're just a creation of God. Right. When you totally live your life to Christ and let him be in your life, then you are God's child.
Right, so you're born again.
You're born again of spirit. Right. So I'm going to pray that they don't do it, because the police officer said that either two things going to happen. It's going to be a cat fight. It's going to be a bloodbath. And he said he's looking for a bloodbath.
Oh, my.
He said that that community, he said that crime, you know, crime go up 50%. He say crime went up 400%. No, 1,500%.
In the Muslim community.
In that Muslim community. And rape, not 75, not 100, but 400%.
And who would want to live under such a religion that is so brutal to its adherents? Who would want to practice a religion that your daughter's going to get raped when she leaves the house?
That's right. That's why they say you go with an escort. You got to have an escort. We're not beating up Muslims. We don't hate them. Listen, when you are a Christ, you love everybody. But at the same time, we're going to give you the truth. We're not going to hold back.
We have to deliver what the Word of God tells us is true. If there has to be a basis of truth. There has to be a foundation from which you base all other truths.
Exactly.
Or it's either a lie or it's of the truth. And the only foundation, Jesus says, I am the truth. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am truth. So anything and everything you find in your Bible, can relate that has been the foundation of truth. But anything man conjures up, if it doesn't line up with the Bible, is not truth. It is error. And the Bible says that God gave us the Holy Ghost so we could discern, had the spirit of discernment, and we could discern the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. And there is a false spirit. There is a false Amen. Church spirit. There's a lot of hooping and hollering.
There you go.
And speaking in tongues and false miracles going on. Because you got all these false prophets
That's
pastoring
right.
these churches.
Exactly.
And there's a lot of hoopla going on in churches today. And they calling it revival. But it's nothing but a Kundalini spirit. If you want to get technical here, it's a Kundalini
Come on,
spirit
brother, break it
that's
down.
Working through those people that are running the show. And they're in the altars and they're howling like wolves and hooping like cranes and everything you can imagine. All these animal spirits are coming in them while they're worshiping God.
Amen.
And they say that's the Holy Ghost. That's the Kundalini spirit that's working
exactly.
in this country. Now, they're confused, and people are, listen, you can pack the house out with that mess.
Yes, you can.
Because those spirits are all in the world. They're all in the people, and they're drawn to it. You see, it's religion, but it doesn't change the heart of man. It doesn't change the destiny of man's soul. Satan would love for you to be in a church that is filled with spirit as long as there ain't any God spirit. Because as long as you're busy thinking you're working for God and it's not Jesus Christ, then you are working for God. That is the devil.
Exactly right.
And that's what he loves. He loves to deceive Christians and get them off on the wrong track. Had a couple ladies a while back come to my house, and they were Jehovah's Witness. And one of the ladies, it was a white lady and a black lady that got out, and I think another black lady might have been driving the car. And they got out, and they came, and they introduced themselves, and I told them, you know, who I was. And she said, you know, I used to go, this white lady said, I know, she said, I used to go to a Baptist church, and then I got converted to become a Jehovah's Witness. I said, well, that really breaks my heart. I'm so sad for you. And she says, you're the second person that's told me that today. And I say, well, you know, you need to listen to what God's telling you, because you left the truth, right? You left the truth and you went into deceit. You went into a lie, and now you're claiming a lie to be the truth.
That's right.
I said, so I do feel sorry for you, because you have deceived yourself. And anybody that's practicing self-deception, it's going to take God and a miracle to get them out of it.
It is. And we had a lady here. I might still get in contact with her. She said that she was a Jehovah's Witness for 20 years and how that God had changed her. And her testimony uh-huh. is awesome. But that is true. We getting a lot of these preachers, like you said, hooping and hollering and bringing all this dead doctrine. And then when you get in the church and they all wrapped up, say, well, what did he preach about? I don't know, but it sure sounded good.
Felt good.
It felt we good. It sounded good. And we had church. But what did he talk about? I don't know. But then here's the thing. You walk in dead, you leave dead.
Right.
You gain no life, not challenge your walk with Christ or anything.
So we're talking about deception. And
That's right.
Let's give our phone number out. So we're opening up the phone lines. Anybody like to call in with a comment or question?
That's me giving the number. The number is 803-335-3131, 803-335-3131. It's crazy how everybody thinks that, oh, you know, maybe if I give my own sermon about how people should feel good, maybe that's the truth, because, you know, I want people to come to my church. And that's not how Jesus works with things. You know, he doesn't just make people comfortable. You know,
yes.
we do know him as the God who protects and, you know, gives us peace, but there's sometimes where he's like, oh no, I gotta tell you the truth, because, you know, you need to fix some stuff. We read in Psalms 33:4, for the word of the Lord is right, and all his works are done in truth. He loveth righteousness and judgment. The earth is full of goodness of the goodness of the Lord. So it says right there that the word is right.
It is right.
And it is the truth. It's done in truth. And that's what preachers need to really remember when they're trying to figure out, okay, what am I going to preach about? Remember, preach about truth. Preach about something that's right.
Yes. So the listeners out there that's listening to our program and that will be listening to a rebroadcast maybe tomorrow of our program, we want you to get your Bible and begin to read it and to study it, because Amen. It is a lamp unto our feet. It is a light unto our pathway. Those who read it and apply it, God gives them wisdom that is out of this world, that is not learned from college and from professors and from political activists or from other activists that have other agendas. It's God's agenda. And if you will read it for yourself, you can find truth in the Word of God. Find truth any place else, and you're going to go into deception.
That's right. That's exactly right. And I'm just going to turn this up just a tad bit. You know, I'm going to go back to Matthew 24 and verse 6, and it said, ye shall hear the wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is yet not. So we talk about rumors of war. Let's talk about 4th of July. I read that scripture for a reason. How that Vladimir Putin flew his bombers. You know, these bombers can carry nuclear weapons and all kind of stuff.
Yep.
And they flew off the coast of California. And when the F-16s or F-22s intercept, they got on radio, and we just want to fly by and tell y'all happy 4th of July.
Yeah, and they did also in Alaska.
That's Alaska. Now, you saying that a lot of y'all are being deceived because the news is telling y'all, we are not going into war. We are the powerful nation. Ain't nobody going to do anything to us. But yet, our common enemy, which is Vladimir Putin, which he doesn't like America, and he sits there and he flies. So I'm sitting there listening to this. Okay, well, this one time. No, this has happened in 2014. They say it happened almost 100 times. Yeah. Where he just fly only 12 miles from Alaska and California.
Yeah.
12 miles now. Now, they telling you that we are a powerful nation. Ain't nobody but these guys off the coast.
Yep.
At any given time, he can say, you know what? Let's bomb them.
You don't know if he's got a bomb on that plane.
You don't know if
he
got a bomb plane or not. And then, you know, and we get so used to it, like, well, we already know what he's doing, and actually bomb America. Now, I did hear a prophecy.
Yeah.
From a Pops McCoy when we at Tent Revival. He said that he see bombs dropping in America. You know, and that people
I've
gonna
heard
be,
other people say
yeah,
that.
And they're gonna be so shocked to see that till they're gonna literally die because they're not gonna run. And like, I can't believe this happened to us. We the powerful nation. Now, he's the same man that prophesied in 1995 that he see a big building falling in New York City, and he see people mourning, and it was a terror attack, and that's when the World Trade Center happened.
Wow.
A lot of people laughed at him, oh, you crazy. But now this come close because Putin, he's been doing it, not us, but just all different nations. He's been going to Turkey, been doing it over there, so this is just a sign to let you know that God is coming soon. The Bible
wars
says,
and rumors of wars.
Rumors of wars,
saying.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's already, this is not hearsay. I mean, just go find out for yourself.
Yeah.
Iran and Russia are working together.
Working together.
Russia sent its scientists to help Iran get its nuclear capacity where it is today.
That's right.
They didn't have the knowledge.
No, they didn't.
They got it from Russia. And Russia and Iran want the sanctions lifted. Russia has sent to Iran missiles that they call defense missiles.
Exactly right.
But these same defense missiles are capable of carrying nuclear warheads. Y'all, come on, wake up.
Why do you think he took over Ukraine?
Why, there you go. That's a warm seaport, and it doesn't freeze over in the winter. That's
right.
Crimea.
That's right.
Crimea River, because here comes Putin.
Boom. That's right.
That's the truth.
We trying to tell y'all, don't be deceived. Listen, what we telling you, buckle down, get a hold to Christ. That's
believe
right.
God, take him at his word, prepare.
Prepare. The word that came in our church and Pastor Steve Church and I'm pretty sure Augusta Washington Church and University Parkway Church of God. God is telling people, seek my face.
Yes, sir.
Seek me. Get into my word.
He tells us all the time, I'm coming.
I'm coming.
I'm coming. Be ready. Be ready. I'm coming.
That's right. I'm
and,
coming.
He wants us to give this word out to the people.
That's right.
Amen. I think when people, when they hear be ready, we don't mean be ready for when he comes. We don't mean like, oh, the doomsday preppers, you know, get a
come
bunker.
Come on, brother. You
get in a hole. No.
Boy, that was hot.
We're talking about, you know, read your Bible, you know, get
there
closer
you go.
To God.
There
look,
you
for,
go.
Look for somebody who can actually help you, and that's God.
Amen. I think you made about 1,000 people mad when you say doomsday prepper. Not that kind. They were like, you mean to tell me I just spent $25 million? I have heard this man spend, was it $15 million?
Preparing for
he's
going to make it through.
He's going to.
Everybody else is going to famish, but this man,
this man
going to make it through.
500. Wait a minute. I think it's 200 feet on the ground. He got the M16, the one that be on the helicopter that turns. If you walk in there, shoot you and all this stuff. And he was bragging, I got this, and I can have up to 300 people living there. And all God got to do is snap a hand, get an earth in, and suck y'all in.
Well, every time man thinks that they have outsmarted God's plan for judgment and destruction, and that they've got their own ideas, God just likes to show them first.
Yes.
That he's still God. You know, when I was a child, I had that same childish idea this rich man's got. Because when I was a child, before I ever got saved, and this is a true testimony I'm going to give to you.
All right.
That when I was a child, I probably was only 9, 10, and God would deal with me. When I was a young child, God dealt with me. And I would be thinking about when I died, I was going to hell as a child. And I would say, you know what? They say you're in hell forever. And this is a child's mentality. I said, but if I'm there forever, I'll figure out a way to build a box and get out of that heat.
Wow.
And I was seriously thinking about it. I was laying in my bed at night at 9 and 10 years old. And I'm thinking, I'll find a material. I'll have to dig deep probably to find something that ain't on fire. And I'll get it and I'll start building my own little protection against the fires of hell. And that was God dealing with the young child.
That's right.
Then that child, when he turned 14, he hit the altar. Because you know what? He tried to build some rabbit boxes, and he couldn't hardly catch a rabbit, much less be in hell and build a box that he could get out of fire. And everybody, most everybody that's not a Christian, has their own little plan about how they're going to get out of that mess, like the preppers do, or how they're going to beg God and tell God they didn't understand the Bible and they tried to read it. And the church was too far away, and they didn't like the pastor anyway.
That
the church was filled with hypocrites, and they didn't go to the church with all them hypocrites because they felt better being at home. And they're going to try it. They've got all these excuses, and they're ready to give them to God. And when God sentences them to hell, there's going to be no boxes to be built down there.
No, sir. I used to think, well, you can't be there forever.
Yeah, yeah. Then you tell yourself, well, God will have – and the other thing is God will have mercy after about a million years.
Yeah.
After I cry and cry and beg. Yeah, and I used to think that too. I'm going to cry out to God and plead and plead. And he's going to come down and say, son, I've heard you. Now get out of this whole place.
Yeah,
you know you don't belong here. But you know what? There's no escape in that place.
There's no escape.
And God don't want you to go there.
That's right.
I think when man tries to think, okay, yeah, maybe I can do something better than God, they try to put themselves on that level of God. And that's not that, you know, we're not made here to be on the level of God. And that's when that Antichrist spirit comes in, the spirit of deception, telling everybody, okay, yeah, you know, we're the same as God and we can do whatever we want. And yeah, we're not. Now we don't have too much time left, but if you want to call with a question or comment, just the number is 803-335-3131, 803-335-3131.
I promise you, call, we won't bite you.
I don't know. You're pretty frisky tonight. You better watch him.
He's like
a cranked up chihuahua, except he weighs in like a
pit bull.
No, like a
Saint Bernard.
Saint Bernard. That's what I was looking for. Big as a Saint Bernard.
I just want the people to be prepared.
I want to go and read my scripture.
Amen. Read the scripture, brother.
I want to talk about in the last days. And it shall come to pass. This is Joel, by the way, chapter 2, verse 28. Very familiar passage of scripture. And it says, it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. Also on my men servants and on my maid servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth. Blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming great and awesome day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Oh, praise God. In the middle of these last days, Joel says, when God is pouring out his fury and the moon is being darkened like blood, sun's being darkened like ash, that God would send a spiritual movement. And even on those uneducated servants, it doesn't matter. God would treat everybody the same, and he would give them of his spirit. And where the spirit of God is, there's life.
Life.
Amen. And listen, there's dreams.
Amen.
And there's visions, and they're coming.
Thank you,
man,
Jesus.
People are having them. I'm having them. I'm having dreams. God dreams. God is showing me things, y'all.
Wow.
And God is telling me things when I'm praying. And I'm telling you, I'm sharing it on this show right now, Jesus is coming. Economic earthquake that is going to shake the world to its core is coming, and on the heels of the economic earthquake that's going to shake all the world, including America first, I'm going to tell you what's behind it. It is a new world order and the mark of the beast. You can say Steve said it. He just said it right here. Pastor Hall is telling you what God is showing him, and it is coming very soon, and it's coming like birth pains on a woman. They start slow. But as he gets closer to birth, they get closer and harder and closer and harder. And I'm telling you, the birth pains are already being felt in this country and around the world, and they're only going to escalate.
That's right. And that, and that's what you think with this Jade Him 15.
What do y'all think's going on?
Well,
come on, be real.
I had did a deep study, and what I understand that it is a military group, but Jade Him acronym stands for Artificial Intelligence. What they do is they get all the cameras, your traffic cam, your I noticed in Augusta, I seen a lot of cameras, and they have a computer probably about five times big as this building. And it feed them intelligence of people. It interacts how the people act. It can let people know that this person or this state is going to be a state of hostile. And this computer is like a big old brain, which is called artificial, and it feeds and it tells the
military where to go,
what to do, how to deal with
preemptive type information.
Yes. So what they do, they get this military and they station them and they say, okay, like for, I'll use a prime example, Texas. The Oliver Town, you need to put military in Texas because this is a state.
You ain't kidding.
That's a long, they call it the Lone Ranger. They do what they want. They fight against homosexuality and came up with their own bylaws.
What does their state flag say? Don't tread on me.
That's right. And do you know Texas have a law that if a police come after you, you can pull your gun and shoot them to defend yourself? They have that law. So that's why Tennessee, I don't know, it took me a while because I'm like, okay, this is just, you know, but it's an artificial intelligence. They even trying to get drones actually
that can think. Right.
Well, they already got the machine that does it thinking. It's like one of the machines where they turn with the little, I call it the little film thing, it turns. That's what that is. And it goes it's all over the world, Pastor. It's not just in America. It's all over the world. Jade Him 15 is all over, and they preparing because they know if the country know that the economy get ready to collapse, what you think going to, especially in America where they haven't experienced that?
There's going to be a rebellion.
They're going to be a big
against
rebellion.
The government because they just cut. They don't have the money. They don't have food.
They don't have
anything. And you think you've seen riots so far?
Wow.
All you've seen was a little race riot.
That's right.
When
that
you get
nothing.
A country that is upset because all of their
money,
is gone. They can't get it out of the bank. There's no food in their house. Their check ain't coming anymore.
That's right.
And who they going to be looking for? It ain't going to be a race thing. Now, there's going to be some race in there, but I'm going to tell you what. It's going to be an American movement, and already getting prepared to squash it with Jane Hill 15 preparations.
That's right.
That's my take on that. I do believe it's military operations that are getting prepared because they know there's going to be an uprising against martial law. Martial law will be declared. That's something else I'm going to tell you. Martial law will be declared.
It will be declared, yeah.
And the state will be taken over by the federal government, and you will lose all of your rights. It's guaranteed to you in the Constitution.
Oh, yeah.
And because you'll lose the right to free speech, if you start preaching and saying things they don't like, they're going to shut you up, and they lock you up if you don't shut up.
That's right.
And then they still may do it if they just don't like the way you,
wear
your tie.
They did it. They did it in British. The man was street preaching, and they grabbed him, and he said he felt like he was treated as a terrorist.
Right.
They sit him in a chair. They had three guys ask him questions, doing things, but he said he like, wait a minute, now this is free, you know, I have the freedom, but he said he was treated like he was from America. He said he was treated like he was a terrorist. I'm like, wow. So we are going to be in some dying times, but I'm telling you, no matter how bad it be, Jesus Christ is always on top.
Amen.
No matter what, all we got to do is lean toward our Father.
Amen.
And he's going to be the, now maybe, you know, some of us may have to go through persecution, but you know what? My heart, my mind is set. If I have to, the Bible say you would suffer for your name's sake, you would die.
Amen. That's what
I'm ready. And I'm not saying this just to impress nobody because I really don't care how nobody feel about me, but I'm ready to die for my Jesus Christ.
Amen. And we all have to be willing. I mean, don't wait until all this stuff happens. You hear like the kind of, don't wait for me like, oh, you know what, they were right, maybe I should get close to Jesus, because you never know what could happen. Maybe
you never know Jesus could come.
That's right.
And we always have to be prepared. It's a process, like we were talking about earlier with RPI. He was saying it's a process that we go through, but you know, it's something that helps you, helps your life, helps your family, and you can actually find peace in somebody that actually gives, you know, actually deserves glory.
Amen. And I don't know what my Holy Spirit, don't know why the Holy Spirit is telling me this, but He's telling me y'all, the ones that you know the word, you believe in the word, and God gonna use you. God say, do not wait until everything get bad to get a voice.
Come
because
on,
your
I
voice
like
ain't
that.
Gonna be heard.
Right.
He said, do it now where your voice can be heard so you can draw plenty of him. I don't know who that is
yeah.
or who I'm talking to, but that was the Holy Spirit telling me, don't wait till the time get in where you try to get a voice because it's not gonna be heard. God say, do your yeah. voice now where it can be heard.
100% on that, brother, because God told me, and I told my church that last
wow.
week.
Wow.
100%.
And did I talk to you about that,
No, we ain't talked about that. Now, one thing God told me is that our church needed to be preemptive. We need to tell people Jesus is coming.
Exactly.
We need to be telling people the economy is going to crash. Things are not going to get better.
It's not.
Don't believe the lies and the hype of media
right.
and the government and all of their stooges that are telling all this trash and lies and deception. Don't believe that. Believe what the Bible says in the last days was going to come to pass. God's Spirit is going to be poured out, but hell on earth is going to come.
Amen.
And you need to be prepared for that. And what that means is you need to give all of your heart and your life to Jesus Christ and start telling the people. And then when it happens, before it happens,
that's
you tell
right.
them before it happens what's going to happen. Then you've got credibility in their sight, and they're going to come to you and say, tell me more about your
exactly.
God who predicted all these things so that I can have peace just like you do.
And then they're going to tell more people and bring more people. And before you know it, God is building an army.
Yeah.
Now, if you can get an army, if I can get five, or I don't got to have five, 75 strong people in the Lord, that's like having a million.
Oh, yeah.
That's going to pray. That's going to stand on the word of God. That's going to not bow down. That's not going to take bad. That's going to just stand and say, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm going to tell you that Jesus loves you, change your life. Go out and preach the gospel. This is what God is looking for. He said,
Amen.
It's time to stand up and get my people prepared for
Amen.
My coming. Because if you're not, you're going to be lost. God said, I need some law-abiding service, Jesus Christ, Holy Ghost crazy. I'm going to spin and scream Jesus out right now on the street corner, in the church, over in the mall, wherever God leads you to do it. God said he needs you
Come
now
on.
Because he is coming. Wake up.
Amen.
Wake up, America. Wake up, Christian.
Amen.
Wake up, sinners. Wake up, homosexual. Wake up, Muslim.
Come on.
All y'all wake up, because when Jesus come, every knee, every tongue
come on.
Will confess and bow down and say his name
is
Jesus Christ.
It's not Muhammad.
It's not Muhammad. And it sure ain't Buddha.
It ain't Obama.
It sure ain't. Oh, no, it definitely ain't Obama.
It so ain't none of the others.
No, we need
only
to stand
one.
Up. Listen, we only got a few minutes. If y'all, anybody got any comments or anything, give us a call. 803-335-3131. Give us a call. We want to hear if there's anybody out there that's standing for Jesus Christ. Call us. Let us know. If you don't call us, then praise God. We know you. We know you're still standing.
Brother, we also intend on what you say, and we don't want to stop you.
That's right.
Man. I mean, we just sucking up what you're putting out, brother.
Well,
go ahead.
I mean, God has given me an urgency to share his gospel to people. That what
yeah.
God, especially my wife. I thank God because God has not only given her a dream, but a vision. God is showing my wife things that is getting ready to happen. We as Christians got to stop sitting down and share this gospel. We got to stop being lazy, stop complaining, stop whining, oh, I'm too tired. But we'll spend all day at work trying to make all the money, or when the weekend come, well, I got to do this, I got to do that. No, let's do what God lead us to do. I don't care if you can't speak, get a track, give it to a person, smile at them. And you know, if you can't, if you don't know what to say, tell them Jesus loves you. That's all God wants you to do, to share his gospel. Stop worrying about what's going to happen. If you're going to get locked up, you get locked up for Jesus. God told me, he said, son, don't worry about anything, because whatever happened, I'm going to provide for your family no matter what. Why? Because you're working for me. You're not working for a Kroger's or McDonald's, or you're not working. You are working for me, the Almighty, the one and only, the first and the last, the Alpha and Omega, Jesus Christ. You are working for me, and when you applaud for me, you get all the benefit plus bonus. So share the gospel. Don't be afraid. We need this right now, because there are people that are hurting and toe up and want to know Jesus, but you too afraid to say something. I'm not the best speaker in the world. I'm tongue twisted. I can barely get a word. I can barely read, but God works through me, and he tells me how to bring the word out.
Yeah.
God can use anybody. If God Amen. Can use a donkey, or he can use a mule, or he can use anything. And we better than that. We better than a donkey. We better than a mule. Why? Because we are his people. The Bible said God created man in his image. Yeah. So if we create in his image, we should have the same, not the exact same benefit, but have the 80-90% benefit that God has given to us from day one. Use those tools, put it to your advantage, save souls.
Amen. Can I take up the offering now? Because we're going to get a good offering. I feel a good offering coming
and
on.
And the credit card number is stopped.
That's a good preaching there, brother.
Well, I'm...
You need to come to my church. You need to bring all that with you.
Man, hey.
Put that in the box and bring it on back.
I come to your church. Your people, they love to pull on me, man.
They'll get you.
Oh, man, I love every last one of them. If you ever go to Johnson Church of God, and I'm not saying that because that's my best friend. I'm saying that because you're going to get a word. And them people, man, they will love you.
They love you. I got one of the best around. Yeah. I brag on my church, and it's the honest truth. Hey. They are. They're that good. They're
right.
Loving people.
I love when y'all was doing deliverance, how y'all just stick together as a family.
Yeah.
And you really look at it, they are in the spiritual realm. They are family, but you think they blood family, how they all stick together and they close and
yeah.
And that's what a church family should be. You should have, as a pastor, you should have a relationship with your church people like your own children.
Brother Minister Steve, come on, say something.
Yeah, I'm going to shut up now.
Well, yeah,
tell us something,
taking
brother.
Up
you
all
just sucked
mic.
Up all this.
I'm
thing.
Sorry.
No, that's okay. It's good.
No, and I mean he's right with all that he's saying. You know, yeah. the church needs to stand up and do something. You know, God really wants his people to be in action so that we can save souls. So that when he comes, you know, we have more people going with us to heaven so they can celebrate with us. And that's all we need to do is stand up. And like RPI said, all we need with is each other. You know, we're a family.
That's right.
You know, when we stick together with our family, we can save souls. We can conquer over the devil. We can do everything. I can do all things in God.
Amen. Right. Wow, we had a good show.
Yeah, we did.
This has went fast, and we were talking about deception, and then we went to a very good preaching spree, and we all enjoyed the preaching spree. I was sucking that up. We got it on tape, too.
Oh, boy.
Like if they want a copy, they can just call you, can't they? I mean,
that's right. You want it on wax? That's what they said. We got it on wax.
You got it on wax.
Yeah.
But God has moved, and I believe God has spoken to our listeners today. And he's telling our listeners, this is what I hear God telling the listeners.
Come on now.
He's telling them, I'm coming. You need to be working.
That's right.
He says, the harvest is great. The labors are few.
Woo.
Pray ye therefore to the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth labors into his harvest. It ain't your harvest. It's his harvest, and he wants you to go to work on his behalf. Friends, if you're not working for Jesus, you're not working at all, because what you gather up working for yourself will burn. It's going to disappear. Nobody's going to ever remember it. But if you doing it for Jesus, it will be an eternal memorial for you in heaven. You need to get working for Jesus. He died for you. He loves you. He's coming to take you home. You need to be working for Jesus. It's my turn to preach now.
That's right.
I mean,
preach
how
much
minutes I got? What's the time?
Yeah, you the vice president. Your time is unlimited.
56. Unlimited time. RPI says this. Amen. But God is trying to tell the listening audience, the church folk in America and across the world, I'm coming. Wake up and get to work.
Amen.
Because
Amen.
There's so many people that would come to church if we would invite them.
Amen.
They would serve Christ if we'd show them the love of Christ.
Come on now.
If we would get sincere with God and begin to pray like everything depended on us, and then believe in God like everything depended on him, we could get a lot done.
A lot done.
Because we're not doing our part. The bottom line is the churches and we as Christians are not doing our part. God is doing his, but we have not met him to do our parts. And our part is to take the gospel.
Amen.
He doesn't send the angels to preach it. And we got a caller. All right, caller, you're live and on the air. Question or comment?
Hey, this is Bishop Dupree, and I was just calling to know that I'm standing with you. I'm enjoying while I'm hearing what you are saying.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
Right, and everything you, and what you said, I was just sharing with another man of God not too long ago that we're looking at where the United States fit in when during the tribulation time during that time, the United States not even mentioned.
That's right.
And,
yeah.
And I say it probably because that every time a nation went under, went went against God and turned their back on God, God put them under another nation.
Amen. Yeah. That's true.
Amen. That's right.
That's right.
Yeah, when Israel did it, they were under Babylon.
That's right.
They turned their back on God.
Yes, sir, brother.
All right.
And God would let that nation rule over them, and until they get tired and they start crying out to God.
Amen.
That's right, brother.
And I believe that's what's going to happen to the United States too. Turn the back on God, and God is eventually going to turn us over into another nation.
That's
Amen,
right.
Amen, brother. I can believe that, brother.
I believe that.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Well, thank you for calling in.
Okay. All right.
It's always a blessing to you, brother.
Always a blessing, brother. Keep up the good work for Jesus. Well, guess what, guys? Brother Pree almost got the last word.
That's right.
Amen. God bless you, Brother Dupree. Thank you for calling in.
Yeah, he got a show on here. They're a really good show. I enjoy listening to him.
Yeah, and look at the clock up there. What time is it?
Oh, we got a minute.
We ain't got a minute, do we? We got seconds.
We got seconds.
We got like 30 seconds.
So you've been listening to Steve Hall. I'm the host for the show. My co-host has been RPI.
Hello.
Our assistant host over here, and the controls has been Brother Stevie Byra.
Amen.
God bless my host, co-host, and all the other hosts that are out there. I'm Steve Hall. Thank you for listening on this Tuesday night, and we want to appreciate you in the Lord. Keep us in your prayers. God's going to use the station to get the word out, but we need to be backed up by our listening audience and their prayers. So we're going to get on off of here. Thank you for listening to us. We look forward to joining you again next Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, and we'll again go through our program called In the Last Days. Hello, everybody, and thank you for listening to 99.9 WUCC, where you always hear the voice of truth. My name is Pastor Steve Hall from the Johnston Church of God, and you are now entering our program,